Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs.
Cured. How the Berlin Patients Defeated HIV and Forever Changed Medical Science. Nathalia Holt. Part 1. A Doctor, Two Patients, and Some Tests. Someday, all this will have to be developed, carefully printed, fixed. Christopher Isherwood, Goodbye to Berlin. Chapter 1. The Good Doctor in Denial. The streets were bursting. The crowd at the March on Washington for gay, lesbian, and bi equal rights and liberation became overwhelming. Dr. Heiko Jessen was finding it difficult to remain calm. Over 1 million people attended the rally. It was a sunny, mild day in April 1993. The cherry blossoms were at the end of their bloom, filling the mall with soft pink and white blossoms. The flowers fell from the trees like a fragrant snow, filling the trees with beauty. Jessen needed a quiet spot to himself. He found a solitary bench far from the talks and demonstrations. As he sat, thousands of miles away from his home in Berlin, one circular train of thought occupied his mind. Andrew. While Andrew stood only a few hundred feet away in the crowd, emotionally he was distant. Their relationship was faltering. Andrew had cheated on him, yes, but Jessen forgave him because he loved him. Now Andrew was complaining of a cold. For most people, a family member complaining of a cold is thoroughly normal. For physicians accustomed to easing the fears of their family and friends, a cold is certainly nothing to be worried about. But Jessen is not like most doctors. As Andrew complained of a sore throat, lethargy, a fever, and then a rash, Jessen became increasingly concerned. His thinking was guided by his experience in his small clinic in Berlin. Every day he saw the same constellation of symptoms. He spoke to young men who were battling what appeared to be the flu. Yet, in the back of their minds, was one event. A night spent with a partner they had just met. A party they couldn't quite remember. A struggle to put on a condom. Many patients were highly specific, detailing their exposure, able to remember the day and hour they became infected. This is because an influenza virus didn't cause their illness. It was often another, very different virus. In medicine, a prodrome is a set of symptoms that heralds the beginning of a disease. These first symptoms are distinct from the disease itself, with traits shared among similar pathogens. Viruses, for example, share a common set of prodromal symptoms. Before we run a fever, get the chills, and become hopelessly nauseated, we usually get an achy, tired feeling. This feeling serves as a warning to our bodies, a signal that we're about to get sick. Some viruses, like shingles and other herpes, share similar beginnings as the virus begins to invade. The virus first goes through an incubation phase. Like an egg sitting in an incubator, the virus hides in our bodies, waiting until it's ready to make its presence known. It is rapidly expanding during this time, madly replicating. Incubation can last anywhere from minutes to decades, depending on the disease and the individual nature of the person infected. This stage provides the virus's chance to build itself up. It's almost as if the virus is training for the fight of its life. By the time it's ready to move to the next stage, revealing the first signs of disease, our immune system is already losing the fight. HIV, like many other viruses, spends the short incubation period wisely. The virus makes millions of copies of itself, all before the body can properly identify it and mount a tailored attack. By the time acute infection begins, tens of millions of viruses have invaded, not only attacking our blood cells, but entrenching itself in our tissues. The virus wipes out the immune system in the gut. It forms a long-lived reservoir in multiple organs, including lymph nodes and bone marrow. The virus hides out in resting immune cells, so-called because they are no longer dividing. The virus integrates itself into the DNA of the cell and then goes dormant. When the cell wakes up again, years, even decades into the future, the virus will wake up with it, insidiously using the cell to make more of itself. These resting T cells are like rare gems in a mine of rocks. Despite their scarcity, HIV is able to discover them. In its isolated hiding place, HIV can remain undetected for decades, beyond the touch of antiviral drugs. The latent virus remains present, but is not obvious, at least to the immune system or to our drugs. This is why we can't fully remove the virus with the therapies we have today. No matter how good our drugs are at tackling the virus, they cannot reach the hidden reservoir of HIV in the resting immune cells. Bob Siciliano, a researcher at the Johns Hopkins University School of Medicine, describes the challenge simply. You are stuck with the virus unless you get every last latently infected cell. Even if an HIV-positive person has taken antiviral drugs for decades, even if they've eliminated all detectable virus in the blood, once they stop taking the antiviral therapy, the virus comes roaring back, returning to the same high levels it enjoyed before any drugs were taken. In less than 1 year, the virus becomes a part of our cells and ourselves. By the time we begin to feel the first mild symptoms of the disease, the virus has enacted wide-scale irreversible damage on our bodies. Yet we remain unconcerned, naively believing that all we're suffering from is the flu. This is why Jessen was distressed to hear about Andrew's cold. Combined with Andrew's infidelity, the picture was worrisome. Jessen turned the facts over in his mind, doubting that he was right to be worried. Was he just being over-anxious about the man he loved? This is the problem with treating your loved ones, he thought. You can't trust your own judgment. While it's generally accepted that doctors shouldn't treat their family members, they frequently do. In the United States, more than 80% of physicians have prescribed medications for a family member. While Jessen knew he was breaking the boundaries of the patient-doctor relationship, he couldn't help himself. He knew it would alarm Andrew, but he had to speak openly with him. On the plane ride back to Berlin, he laid bare his fears. Andrew, nervous, agreed to an HIV test. Jessen performed the test himself in his clinic in the gay neighborhood of Schönebeck in the former West Berlin. The clinic took up the second floor of an ornate building built at the turn of the 20th century in the opulent Beaux-Arts style. The floor was divided into space for a clinic and an apartment where Jessen lived. Returning to medicine after German reunification in the early 1990s had not been easy. There were limited opportunities for doctors to establish their own practices. In a country with universal health care, the German government tightly regulates medical providers, including the opening of private clinics. Germany has since experienced a shortage of doctors, but in the early 1990s there was a surplus, which made new clinics near impossible. Jessen managed to squeeze in his request just before the government temporarily shut down all new private clinic applications. Today, new clinics rarely open. Instead, they are handed off from one physician to the next. For his practice, Jessen created his own medical training, outside the constraints of academia. He devised a combination of specialties that would cater to the specific health needs of gay men: primary care, infectious disease, and sports medicine. He was particularly interested in helping vulnerable gay teenagers with no place to turn, who could come to his practice for treatment, counseling, and understanding. Jessen had completed specialized training in infectious disease for obvious reasons. He included sports medicine because he knew gay men spend time at the gym and subsequently had sports injuries. He found like-minded doctors to join his new practice, including a counselor trained to attend to the psychological needs of his patients. Renovating the old apartment into a new, fresh clinic with the modern aesthetic Jessen wanted proved to be a challenge. Ever the family doctor, Jessen made house calls in the neighborhood during the protracted renovation. Jessen's parents, who lived on the family farm in northern Germany, came down to help. It took 3 months of scraping, plastering, and painting to get the walls of the clinic ready. Jessen's supportive family was always close by, one way or another. A few years later, Arne, Heiko's brother, would come to work for him as a physician in the clinic. Heiko Jessen had grown up on his family's farm, working with cattle after school in summers. Because Jessen was the eldest son, his grandfather was adamant that he one day take over the farm himself. Their small village had even celebrated when Jessen was born, for his birth was seen as extreme good luck, a son to carry on the family tradition. Yet his father had other ideas. Since he had been pressured into becoming a farmer like his dad, he wanted his son Heiko to find his own path. After Jessen finished his medical school studies in Berlin, he moved to San Francisco for his medical fellowship and to see what the United States had to offer. In much of the world, HIV was ending lives in rapidly growing numbers. This was especially evident in San Francisco in the late 1980s. Young male patients, desperately ill, overwhelmed hospitals where no effective treatment could be given. The scenes were hopeless. For Jessen, a young gay physician, it was simply too much. It was the first time he had been exposed to the enormous impact of HIV in the gay community. In San Francisco, Jessen says, gay life meant HIV. He felt himself withdraw from medicine. The sight of so many young men destroyed by disease made him question why he wanted to practice medicine in the first place. One thing he was sure of, he had no future in treating HIV patients. He couldn't handle it. He returned to the German countryside, feeling confused about his future. Should he take an easy path? He considered becoming a country doctor. The simplicity of being settled near his family's farm was tempting. This all changed in 1989, the moment he heard that the Berlin Wall had fallen. He immediately packed his bags. Part of this rush to return to Berlin was to take part in the enormous cultural experience and celebration of his city and country. For Jessen and others flocking to the city, Berlin had become a big party. In the East, everything fell apart. There were no rules, no rent. It was the perfect escape from being a doctor. When he was once again in Berlin, Jessen relaxed into the party scene. For 6 months, he stayed away from medicine, filling his days with friends and parties. Beneath a sea of celebration, he tried to numb his mind to the horrible cases he had seen in San Francisco. It seemed to be working. The young, ambitious, brilliant physician was able to pursue a life outside a hospital. Here was an urban gay culture that was far from the culture of fear and despair he'd found in San Francisco. Eventually, he rented a small apartment in the Schöneberg neighborhood in the former West Berlin. The neighborhood was quiet compared to the raucous parties and the squatter apartments of what used to be East Berlin. The neighborhood was leafy green, full of tree-lined streets. Small neighborhood gardens sat nestled between old, ornate apartment buildings. The neighborhood still bore scars from World War II. Delicately sculpted, Baroque-style buildings stood next to newly constructed monstrosities sporting ugly, flat facades, the result of speedy patch-up jobs following the end of the war. One night, at yet another boisterous party, he met a young American. The party was held, as so many were, in a squatter's apartment, which still held remnants of former occupants, former lives behind the Iron Curtain. As Jessen worked his way through the crowd, Andrew suddenly stood out. The American looked like a teenager in high school. His youthful complexion and bright eyes suggested a happy-go-lucky personality. The child of West Coast liberal parents, Andrew was charismatic, spontaneous, and adventurous. He embodied the complete opposite of Jessen's measured personality. That night, Jessen, as he describes it, met the love of his life. This one man would rouse Jessen to pursue an HIV therapy without precedent. There's no sign outside the door of Jessen's clinic. Instead, a humble sign in the window lets you know there's a medical clinic within. You enter the building through a dark, dirty vestibule. In front of you, an aged staircase, dusty and winding, with no natural light, leads 4 flights up to the clinic entrance. The stairs serve as a fearful anteroom for patients expecting bad news. These were the steps Andrew climbed as he met Jessen at his clinic and home. They had returned from D.C. a few weeks earlier. The clinic was open 7 days a week and didn't close for holidays. Andrew always knew where to find Jessen. The wall that separated clinic from home was more a thin membrane. It was impossible to keep Jessen from his work. Jessen broke the news to Andrew. He had given so many HIV diagnoses before to so many young men like Andrew. He was gentle as usual, but this was different. He was diagnosing his own boyfriend, his partner, the man he loved and trusted. They held each other in Jessen's apartment, tears streaming down both their faces. It was 1993. Everyone with HIV died of AIDS. There was only one drug available to treat HIV, AZT, azithromycin, and it wasn't able to keep people alive. Jessen's thoughts immediately raced to the researchers he knew and to an upcoming conference. He would do anything he could to keep Andrew alive. In the back of his mind, he considered his own risk. He'd had sex with a man who was HIV positive. Intellectually, he knew he should get tested, but he pushed this thought down. He rationalized his reluctance by saying to himself that Andrew needed him right now. He would think about testing himself after he found a therapy for Andrew. Despite the fact that he was a physician, that he knew how deadly the virus was, he remained stuck in his denial. Andrew felt lucky to have Heiko Jessen in his life. His friends, however, were not so trusting. They believed that Jessen was making up the diagnosis. They thought this doctor was manipulating the result in an effort to exert control over Andrew. Even after another physician confirmed the diagnosis, the friends remained paranoid. They tried to convince Andrew that it was a conspiracy, even going so far as to say that activists from ACT UP, the influential AIDS advocacy group, had infected him. Despite these influences, Andrew believed and trusted Heiko. He was HIV positive. Since Jessen was going to push the boundaries of existing HIV medicine, that trust was about to get the ultimate test. But Andrew was never to become one of the Berlin patients who are famous in research circles. He left both Jessen and Germany. Andrew's gift was the passion he gave Jessen to pursue a novel and risky strategy against AIDS. Jessen's experience with Andrew fueled his commitment to be a new kind of family doctor, one who had the courage, the audacity, the temerity to pursue a cure for HIV. This passion would lead him to treat two men who would change medical history and would, in the process, each receive a title befitting a mystery novel, The Berlin Patient. Chapter 2. A Visit with the Family Doctor. In 1996, Christian Hahn walked through a crowded Berlin neighborhood on a beautiful sunny day in early summer, the kind of day when it is hard to imagine anything bad could happen. The streets were filled with people sitting outside cafes. Music streamed from bars and clubs despite the early afternoon hour. Christian made his way to the small, unassuming clinic popular among gay men. The month before, on May 10th, he had done something foolish. He had been at a party. He'd had unsafe sex. Then, in the week that followed, he became ill. The infection made him sick and very tired. He had a sore throat and swollen lymph nodes. It reminded him of chickenpox. He believed he was infected with a virus, but not HIV. As the sickness raged, he decided to make an appointment with his family doctor, Heiko Jessen. He met Jessen at his bustling clinic and told him his fears, detailing with precision the exact dates of his unprotected sex and illness. Heiko Jessen wasn't just anyone to Christian. He was his doctor, but like many of Jessen's patients, he also considered him to be a friend. Jessen was close in age to Christian, both in their late 20s. Jessen had opened his clinic 5 years earlier. Having lived through his own HIV scare, he was better able to empathize with his patients. He still thought about Andrew, the young man who had broken his heart and who was healthy, living with HIV and a new boyfriend in Spain. 4 months after Andrew's positive test, Jessen took his first HIV test. It is hard to understand why a physician who knows the importance of treating early would wait to test himself, but love can be illogical. The test was negative. Jessen's waiting room seemed to be constantly bursting with patients, and he found himself ending each day completely exhausted. Yet he thrived on the intangible rewards that came from directly helping his patients. He told his friends and colleagues that he wasn't focused on research. He wanted to work with people. As soon as he heard Christian talking about his flu-like symptoms, his mind jumped to HIV. Among the young, gay clientele of his practice, Justin saw a lot of the virus. It was common for him to be suspecting HIV in a patient. Sitting at the desk in the exam room, Justin spoke in a clear, calm voice. "We'll test you," he said, making eye contact with Christian. "We'll draw some blood. Tomorrow you'll come back and we'll talk. In a week, we'll have the results." Justin didn't rush him. He answered Christian's questions the best he could. It was obvious that Christian wasn't worried. He didn't believe he was infected. But as Justin saw it, Christian's exposure matched up perfectly with his flu-like symptoms. It was exactly what acute HIV infection looked like. Justin started his pre-test counseling, which he gives all patients who could be infected with HIV, to prepare them for the results, whatever they might be. This counseling is a mix of empathy, science, and prevention whipped together to emotionally prepare a patient for the diagnosis. It helps patients recognize risky behavior and to understand how the HIV test works and what will happen if the test is positive. Jessen has become expert in ways to speak to patients about their HIV diagnoses. He even teaches a course, Breaking Bad News, to medical students at Humboldt University of Berlin. There are two tests used in the clinic to detect HIV. The first detects our body's response to the virus. The second detects the virus directly. The first kind is an antibody test. Our body makes antibodies as a way to snare invaders. The problem with this kind of test for HIV is that it takes time for our body to make antibodies against HIV, on average 25 days. A month is a long time to wait for an HIV diagnosis. While most people in the 1990s received an antibody test for HIV, Jessen decided to order a PCR-based, polymerase chain reaction test for Christian. Jessen knew that, if his hunch was right and Christian had been infected, it would be too early for his body to begin making antibodies against the virus. Instead, he would have to test for the virus directly. The only way to measure the virus itself, instead of the body's response to it, was a PCR test. Performed in the lab, PCR-based tests identify specific parts of HIV, the genes found in every virus. The process causes the virus to multiply so that it can be detected in very small numbers. Ordering this test was unusual at the time. Most physicians simply waited a month and then used an antibody test. Jessen, however, was influenced by the emerging research from David Ho's laboratory. Ho, a researcher in New York City, had a theory that initiating treatment early in HIV infection was key. Therefore, HIV diagnoses had to be made early. Jessen asked Christian to return for the results of the new lab test. Christian had close friends and a warm, loving family, but he told no one he was being tested for HIV. Since he didn't believe he was HIV positive, why mention it to anyone else? Christian had grown up in a rural area in southern Germany. He remembers his childhood as a happy one. He was interested in pursuing linguistics and began studying the topic at a school in his hometown before deciding to move to the capital city in 1995. Christian loved Berlin. The city was so different from his small hometown of 10,000 people. Although shy, he began to make lots of friends at his university. His social life was exhilarating, as it so often is for newcomers to city life. Then, at a party, he did something risky. Had sex with a man he barely knew. Now, here he was, only a year after moving to the big city, getting his first HIV test. Despite the media attention HIV was receiving in Berlin, Christian felt insulated from the epidemic. He knew no one who was HIV positive. "There was a man on the cover of Time magazine," Christian recalls, referring to David Ho, the person who would influence his own cure, but whom he can barely remember. While the German newspaper Der Spiegel was reporting the increasing cases of HIV worldwide in 1995, it was hard for Christian to connect the dire statistics he read about with the reality of his group of healthy young friends. As he sat in the clinic waiting room a week after his first visit and heard his name called, he felt relaxed and confident when he stood up to see his doctor. Jessen told a nurse to prepare tea. It was a sign to the nurse that he was about to deliver an HIV diagnosis. He liked to have everything ready to comfort the patient as soon as he was done talking with him. Jessen entered the exam room and shook hands with Christian. He sat in a chair on the other side of the desk, just a few feet away from the exam table. The room was all white. White walls, a white exam bed, thin, gauzy white curtains that ballooned out from the large open windows. The style of the furniture was modern, chrome and dark wood. Jessen started by giving what he calls a warning shot before he broke the bad news. "I don't have good news for you," Jessen said to Christian, looking him straight in the eye, and he paused a few beats. This would hardly be the only HIV diagnosis he would give that day. His waiting room was crowded with infected young men. But Jessen was especially gentle with Christian, even when he said simply, "Your HIV tests came back positive." He wanted to impress upon him the seriousness of the virus, but he also wanted to assure him that there was treatment available and that it was critical to start the drugs immediately. With the bad news, Jessen embraced Christian, rubbing his back to soothe him. While breaking the news to Christian, Jessen assessed his patient's personality. Jessen was already unusual among family doctors in having begun to combine research with his practice. As he sat with Christian, he wondered if he could benefit from an experimental new drug, a drug he was giving sparingly to a small group of patients early in their infection. Jessen had been the first to give the drug to an HIV patient. The first patient was his boyfriend, Andrew. Now Jessen wondered if the drug had the ability to help people worldwide, and if Christian, a responsible young man, could be part of this trial. Christian felt eerily calm as he heard that he'd tested positive. He couldn't wrap his brain around the reality of the situation. He was unable to comprehend what he was told, and unable to process the fact that his life was about to radically change. It was as if Jessen were speaking in a foreign language, and Christian struggled to understand the meaning. They talked. They paused. They talked again. Jessen was patient. He had become accustomed to volatility in patients' reactions, but he was already thinking Christian could be counted on to take his medicine reliably. "We're testing a new drug that might be able to eliminate HIV," Jessen began. Christian only nodded, asking no questions. He would take whatever Jessen told him to take. Jessen's idea was to initiate therapy early with an aggressive drug regimen before the virus could take hold in the body. For this trial, Jessen selected only patients who were very early in infection and whom he trusted to be reliable. He reviewed with Christian the drugs he would need to take and when. The whole idea of combining drugs was new in 1996, and Christian would be taking three: didanosine, indinavir, and hydroxyurea. When scientists working at Roche, then one of the world's largest biotechnology companies, solved the crystal structure of HIV's protease enzyme in 1989, it cleared the way for a new strategy to treat HIV. Multiple pharmaceutical companies used the structure of the viral enzyme to design a new, effective class of drugs. One of those was indinavir, available from Merck and approved 3 months after Roche's inhibitor, zequinavir. This was the drug Christian would take. Unlike the brand new protease inhibitors, hydroxyurea was an experimental drug that only a handful of people worldwide were testing, and Jessen thought it might be capable of purging the virus from the body. The problem with all these drugs was that they lasted only a short time in the body. This meant that Christian would have to take didanosine twice a day, indinavir 3 times a day, and hydroxyurea 3 times a day. The drugs had to be taken at precisely the right time in order to keep the virus in check. Jessen explained that they would need to take another blood sample for further confirmation, and that Christian would need to come back the next day. He wrote Christian a certificate that gave him 2 weeks off from his school internship. He then sent Christian to the tea room, where he would talk to a nurse for 2 hours and drink tea. And that was that. Years later, Jessen said, I had no indication of how special he would be. Christian, for his part, did not feel special at the time. He folded the instructions in his hands and shuffled out of the office. He wasn't sure how he was supposed to feel, but he was certain he was not having the right reaction. He wished he could cry or moan or be somehow demonstrative. Instead, he felt numb and alone. That night, he would write out the complicated schedule of drugs he was about to take. Jessen had convinced him that these drugs were key. All he had to do was adhere to his schedule and never miss a dose. What neither of them knew is that, a year later, Christian would become an anomaly. Researchers would start writing about him as the Berlin patient, and his story would change the HIV field forever. At the same time Jessen was putting Christian on an experimental new therapy, another one of his patients was receiving a standard treatment regimen. That man, diagnosed later in infection, was 3 years older than Christian and also living in Berlin. Although they never met, their early experiences in being diagnosed with HIV were eerily similar. They spent time with some of the same people, went to the same doctor, hung out in some of the same clubs and restaurants. That man, Timothy Brown, would also become known as the Berlin patient, although he was the second such one. These men, despite the very different therapies they received, would share in a unique experience. They were both cured of HIV. Chapter 3. Death Sentence. Sweat dripping down his face and back, Timothy Brown leaned against the brick wall. He was excited and out of breath, his heart pounding frantically in his chest. The deep beat of techno music seemed to pulse through the wall and pull him back into the packed club. In the 1990s, Tresor was a legendary underground techno club. It was the place to be in Berlin, with lines often stretching down the block. Located in the center of the former East Berlin, its name, Tresor, roughly translates as the vault. This one, unlike the crypts once concealed in Gothic cathedrals, was located in the defunct bank vault of a gone-out-of-business department store. Timothy loved Berlin. He loved the nightlife, his friends, his boyfriend. Life couldn't seem to get better for him than it was in Berlin in 1995. The place was experiencing a rebirth as people from all over the world flocked to the reunified city. In Christopher Isherwood's memoir, filled with his experiences in Berlin in the late 1920s and early 1930s, he writes, "Berlin meant boys." Berlin in the 1990s was reminiscent of that earlier time of sexual liberation before World War II. Timothy was experiencing that kind of freedom. People who knew Timothy found him terribly charming. He reveled in being with his friends, flirting with everyone, and filling up small spaces with his staccato laughter. He was a student in Berlin, still unsure what he wanted to study. To pay the bills, he worked at Café Einstein, located right at the foot of Checkpoint Charlie. This famous Berlin Wall crossing point, where travel was once restricted between West and East Germany, was now a bustling tourist destination. The cafe was constantly packed with travelers. Standing outside Tresor that summer night, Timothy thought about Marcus, an old boyfriend he'd dated for 6 months nearly 2 years earlier. Marcus had been constantly jealous, always imagining that Timothy was off chasing other men. They were traveling in Greece when Marcus abruptly broke up with him on the island of Mykonos. Timothy was miserable when Marcus left him. Now, waiting on Timothy's answering machine was a message from the man he still thought about. Marcus wanted to see him. In the face-to-face meeting, though, Timothy's daydreams were shattered. Marcus wasted no time in getting to the point. "Hey, I got tested for HIV and I tested positive," he said. "You need to get tested too." Timothy didn't take the news lightly. This was the mid-1990s, and he knew HIV was the leading cause of death in Americans aged 25 to 44. The previous March, Timothy had said goodbye to a dear friend who had been diagnosed only a year earlier. Everyone who was diagnosed with the disease died, and Timothy had lost so many friends. HIV was a death sentence. There was no good treatment and no cure. Timothy knew that just because Marcus was positive for HIV didn't mean he himself would be. In fact, Timothy was sure he wasn't HIV positive. He had been pretty careful. However, one night stood out in his mind. A night before he'd ever met Marcus. Usually, when he had sex, he asked his partner to not ejaculate inside him. It wasn't a perfect solution. It couldn't protect him from the diseases he knew were out there, but it was better than nothing. One man he had been with, Jeremy, had blatantly ignored that request. It was to this man that Timothy's thoughts began to turn. He had seen him only once since that night. It was a casual meeting. As he spoke pleasantries, only one thought dominated his brain. "You're the guy that ejaculated inside me." Was it possible that Timothy had infected Marcus? That he himself was HIV positive? A few weeks after Marcus announced he was HIV positive and that Timothy needed to get tested, Timothy sat in a small, clean clinic located in the Institute of Tropical Medicine of Charité Hospital. It was 1995, and the first time Timothy was seeing a doctor since he'd moved to Berlin. A decade later, after he was diagnosed with cancer, he would come to know the hospital well, its rooms and walls becoming like a second home to him. But this was his first time here, and he had trouble finding his way in the labyrinth of halls. As he sat in the waiting room of the tropical medicine clinic deep within the belly of the hospital, he realized he was feeling the same anguish he'd felt in the clinic back in Seattle when he got his first HIV test years before. The waiting was terrible. It had taken weeks to get the results. While the kind of test Heiko Jessen gave Christian Hahn is often used today to detect early HIV, in 1995, these tests were new and rarely used. Instead, the common test was the ELISA, or enzyme-linked immunosorbent assay. It determines whether or not our immune system is responding to the virus. That is, the ELISA detects the antibodies our body makes against the virus. Any pathogen that invades our body makes itself known to the immune system by showing little pieces of itself on the surface of the cell it has invaded. These pieces of a pathogen, called antigens, invoke a response from the immune system. Once the body detects the antigens, distinct for each virus and bacteria, it mounts an immune system attack. The immune system attack comes in two waves. The first wave is from the innate immune system, which is composed of a farrago of deterrents. It includes cannibal-like cells that eat other infected cells and inflammation that creates a physical barricade between the infection and the rest of the body. The innate immune system can be soldiered up quickly in response to a pathogen because it uses the tools already on the shelf. However, the second wave of the immune system attack, from the acquired immune system, takes more time. The acquired system develops new weapons designed for the invading pathogen. To mount its attack, the acquired system uses the blood's infection-fighting white blood cells, specifically lymphocytes, comprised of T cells and B cells. T cells are named for the location where they become differentiated from stem cells, in the thymus, and B cells for their differentiation in bone marrow. For HIV, this custom-made immune response takes time, from weeks to months. The average time is about 25 days. If you come upon a nail and then invent a hammer so you can use the nail, you probably wouldn't throw away the hammer after you use the nail. After all, you might find another nail. Just so, once the B cells make those antibodies for HIV, or any virus, the infected person's immune system will always remember the virus and continue to make those same antibodies, just in case, for the rest of the person's life. To perform the ELISA test, we take a small amount of purified blood, which is called plasma and is a translucent yellow. We dilute it several hundredfold and put the diluted plasma into the well of a so-called 96-well plate. This plate, made of clear plastic, is molded with 96 tiny dimples, or wells, for holding liquid. The amount is tiny, the size of a few raindrops. Inside each well is an antigen, a piece of the virus just large enough to attract the attention of the still-functional immune system contained in the well. If the immune cells immediately recognize the virus and attack it, the test is positive, indicating that the person from whom the blood was taken is infected with HIV. But how do we know if the immune cells are attacking? We don't need lab technicians to peer through a microscope at what is going on. In the case of a positive result, when the person's antibodies bind to the foreign intruder, the fishing line is reeled in. The antibody is captured on the hook, and a brilliant purple dye in the other end of the fishing pole is released. The well turns purple. The darker the color, the stronger the immune system response. If a person's diluted blood plasma makes no antibodies to HIV, they have never seen the virus before, and no purple dye is released. Go fish. The ELISA is labor-intensive, requiring skilled technicians to prepare the materials, load them onto the microplate, carefully wash the plate, and read the results. It is a very sensitive test. It accurately diagnoses HIV in 99.9% of those infected. But there are two big weaknesses. As we've seen, it takes our body's time to make antibodies against HIV, so a person can be infected for months and still be negative on an ELISA. For this reason, ELISAs aren't typically given until at least 6 weeks after an exposure to HIV. The ELISA is very accurate if you've made antibodies to the virus, but not accurate at all if it's too early after infection. The second weakness is the amount of time the test itself takes to run, about 2 weeks. These are 2 weeks full of torment. In 1995, the year Timothy tested positive, it was estimated that approximately one-third of patients who tested positive for HIV did not return for their results. Today, you can buy a rapid HIV test called OraQuick at a local pharmacy. This test is like holding an ELISA in the palm of your hand, but even better, since it requires no blood from you. Using a swab, you collect mucosal transudate from your mouth. Unlike saliva, which comes from a gland in the mouth, mucosal transudate resides in the cheeks. This clear fluid mixes with saliva in the mouth, the two indistinguishable. The transudate, however, as it comes from the cheeks, is enriched with antibodies. While there isn't any measurable HIV in the mouth, the antibodies that every HIV-positive person makes are released into their tissues and blood. These are what the test is swabbing for. The swab is placed in a vial containing replica pieces of HIV. These replicas look like HIV, but they can't infect anyone. If they are present, antibodies attack them. This causes a color-changing enzyme to react. In about 20 minutes, a line will appear in a box on the device, much like on home pregnancy tests that so many women have inspected with emotions ranging from hope to fear. On the OraQuick test, if a second line appears, you are HIV positive. The home test is very accurate, although not quite as good as the laboratory version. Today, all this can be done in your living room, but in 1995, the long wait ended with a potentially life-changing visit to the doctors. Jessen worries about the downside of home HIV tests, though, saying, "It's not news that anyone should have to deal with alone." His opinion is shared by other physicians, particularly family doctors, who believe that counseling is an important component of an HIV diagnosis. It's a difficult balance between making HIV testing convenient and making sure that patients receive the support they need. Apart from the emotionally traumatic aspects of an HIV-positive diagnosis, new testing technologies came at just the right time, making possible a critical step forward on the road to the cure of HIV. The Tropical Medicine Institute at Charité Hospital was time-worn, with faded paint and old furniture. Patients described the clinic as dark, with only a soft gray light filtering in from small upper windows. A poster on the wall read, "AIDS geht alle an Problem." AIDS is everyone's problem, and presented black and white photographs of men and women, their heads bowed as if in prayer. Timothy was called into a small room. He shook hands with a doctor who held his test results in his hand. Timothy's lips trembled. On hearing a diagnosis of HIV, some patients seem to know or suspect. Some can give the exact time and place they were infected, and others are shocked and never saw it coming. The immediate impact of the diagnosis, whether a person falls apart or is brave for the medical staff, is like a snowflake, as unique as the person.
Timothy wanted to. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.